Howdy, folks. Trevor here, spewing the fumes of hatred. And this is a hatred I'm spewing. Atrocity with their debut album from 1990, Hallucinations. This is the original US pressing. Crazy good technical death metal. In the old school way, of course. They would go on, you know, in the middle years, doing a lot of experimenting with like gothic and like electronic shit. I wouldn't say it worked too well, but they, these last three albums have been a series called Occult. So they've put out three of them so far. I'm not sure if they're making a fourth, or maybe it's just supposed to be a trilogy, but yeah, the last three, Occult 1, 2, and 3, have this perfect mesh of death metal and gothic elements. Highly recommend them. Highly recommend this, of course. So, not waste too much time with the intro. I'm just going to give you 10 bands that went from PG to poo-poo. My criteria is they have to have multiple good albums. So it can't just be a band that had a great debut and then plummeted the rest of the way. Because I could be here all night. So I'm going to start with... And I'm not going to try and make them too obvious. So two obvious ones that come to mind would be Sepultura and Slayer. But everybody knows they sucked after their classic period, right? So I will say Slayer sucked after Seasons. Sepultura sucked after Arise. But with Sepultura... I wanted to address this real quick. So somebody mentioned in my top 10 three album runs, they mentioned Sepultura and I didn't put them in there. I'm like, fuck. Because now that I'm thinking about totally would with Morbid Visions, Schizophrenia, and Beneath Remains. But anyway, first band, Demolition Hammer. Anybody that knows a band is aware of a Time Bomb that came out after these two records, and I don't know if it was pressure from the label. I mean, it is Century Media, so I could definitely see him doing that, but Earache was doing that shit around the same time too. Because I know Earache had, you know, fucking Fudge Tunnel, and yeah, it just reminded me of like Fudge Tunnel and I don't know, like Biohazard or something like that. Not that I'm shitting on Biohazard, but it's Demolition Hammer. It went from this hyper aggressive, nasty, fucking brutal thrash to basically like, sludgy garage rock or whatever. So, obvious one, but that's my first one. People are going to be pretty divided on this based on where they ended. Next one is Celtic Frost. That's the correct way to pronounce it, by the way. Don't fight me on it. I know a lot of people will. Call it what you want, I don't care. I always call it Celtic. So Morbid Tales with the Emperor's Return EP. I don't know why they didn't address Emperor's Return on the back of this, but that's my favorite Celtic Frost material. And to Megatherion, which I like quite a bit, but not as much as everybody else seems to. Didn't like Into the Pandemonium. We don't even need to talk about Cold Lake. I actually really enjoy Vanity Nemesis. Yeah, Vanity Nemesis. So, I appreciate the versatility on this album, and they did it right, in my opinion. Love the hooks on it. Love the female vocals that are sprinkled in parts of the album. Tom, I thought his voice sounded great. It was kind of melodic, but it was a great tone. The riffs were, you know, pretty killer. You know, not as like fuck you as To Make a Therion or Morbid Tales, but they were quality riffs. After that, it was a fucking demo they put out that was just absolutely unforgivable. I don't even remember. We called this demo, it was like fucking techno. Prototype, god. Yeah. I wish I could forget that one as easily as Tom did, because dude seems to completely forget about all the shit that he talked about Hellhammer, and now they're doing Hellhammer shit. But Monotheist, I don't dig it at all. Just really, like, way too doomy for me. Drony, it just puts me to sleep. I would honestly rather go picking out socks or something. Cold Lake, to me, is probably more entertaining than Monotheist. Just because, like, it's so bad that's kind of funny, whereas Monotheist just sort of pisses me off with how boring it is. So that's my Celtic Frost pick. I want to get this out of the way. It's pretty big discography. So huge band, of course, but I just feel like they're kind of way too protected based on their legacy. Talk about Iron Maiden. Love this. Don't need to talk about it. We all know how good it is. Killers, again. Getting out of order here. Number of the Beast is a little spotty for me, so I love 22 Acacia Avenue. This version also has Total Eclipse on it, which I think is fantastic. Invaders is terrible. Children of the Damned is okay. I always hated Run to the Hills. Number of the Beast is a good song, just that I never need to hear it again. Rest of it, you know, pretty good. But I just never latched on to the album as much as other people. Not that it's a stinker by any means. Same with Peace of Mind. Getting an album I'm just not as heavily into as everybody else. But it's still got enough merits for me to enjoy it. Sleep. Starting to kick it up a notch here. Still not as good to me as the, you know, the first two. But this does sneak into the top five. Somewhere in Time. So this one fights the first two for first place. Pretty frequently. I would say this often comes out on top. It's got my favorite Iron Maiden song, Caught Somewhere in Time. The only thing that I don't like is the chorus for Heaven Can Wait, and that's when they start throwing in these choruses that just bug the shit out of me. Heaven Can Wait, Heaven Can Wait. I talked about this album in my first ever video. good overrated albums. I still feel that way about this one. Can I Play With Madness is one of the worst Iron Maiden songs. I dig Moonchild, Infinite Dreams. The Seventh Son with Seventh Son is a skipper. And again, Chorus Repeats on him. Clairvoyant is awesome. There's another one of my favorites, top five, is where they stripped it down, took out the bullshit, and that was on the previous album. It's got some of my favorite Maiden tracks. Self-titled, Public Enema number one, Fate's Warning, Mother Russia. Another one that's been kind of creeping up my list too, as far as favorites. This could very well be number six. One of my favorite intros to an Iron Maiden album, which is Be Quick or Be Dead. The Fugitive, great song. Love the chorus on that. Judas Be My Guide is my second favorite Iron Maiden song. I honestly love Weekend Warrior. And once you get past the intro, like, I know a lot of people, you know, kind of gave up on that song, and I totally get it, but because I've been there. Remember the first time I heard that song? Just like, hey, I'm skipping. But once I sat through the whole thing, it became irresistible, especially the solo. So then we get to the Blaze Bailey era. You know, if they had catered to his style of vocal, just 3 minute songs, maybe 4 minutes, kind of, you know, I think if they had the same kind of mindset that they did during the Killers album, it would have been a lot more successful, you know. Or, if you want to borrow from the Blaze Project, could have done something that was, you know, done on the Wolfsbane album. Just speed it up. Don't, you know, throw in your huge Queensryche and Rush influence. It would have been a great record. Man on the Edge is a banger, and that's pretty much it. And I don't remember the song, but it's the ongoing theme for the rest of Iron Maiden's career, is the fucking chorus. I can't remember what the fucking song was called, but the chorus is hilarious. So bad. Knowing that Blaze has that one specific register, I don't know, something a little sabotagey about that record. The next one, Virtual 11. I don't even want to talk about Angel and the Gambler. Klansman is a good song, but it's way better when Bruce sings it. Then we get the comeback, Brave New World, which I dig, but I don't look at it as highly as everybody else seems to. I dig Ghost of the Navigator, but again, stretches out too long. I think if they trimmed it by a couple minutes, it would have been a masterpiece. Brave New World, I really like a lot. You know, cut the chorus a little bit again, you know, it'll definitely remind you what the song title is. That's basically, you know, their shtick at this point. But it's solid. Dance of Death, same thing. This is the one that people will shit on a lot, but, I mean, I love the title track and, Passchendaele, Age of Innocence, No More Lies, again, suffers that repeated chorus, but it's a good song. After that, though, goddamn cat. After that, though, I'm out. Matter of Life and Death. God. Just tried it. I think I tried listening to it maybe 8 times. I really wanted to like it. I think because of the cover art, to be honest, but I just couldn't do it. It was a chore. Final Frontier was horrifically fucking bad. Book of Souls. Again, with the fucking woes. Same with Brave New World, I forgot to mention that. The Wicker Man. Whoa! And then literally does the same thing in fucking Red and the Black. Whoa! And Senjutsu's, again, 2-minute acoustic intros every fucking song. Three riffs, 5 lead breaks, stretch it out 10 minutes a song. Every album for the past, 4 records. So that's my take on Maiden. For me, if you're gonna stretch a song out 10 minutes, put more than 3 riffs in it. Take notes from Venom when they did At War with Satan. 20-minute masterpiece. Okay, so cover 3. All right. One probably people weren't expecting, the Rods. I know I'm missing a couple. They had 6 albums in the 80s. I have 4 of them. They're all spectacular. Good hard-nosed, muscular heavy metal. It's a generic topic. So rock and roll, sex, drugs. That's really good shit. It's high energy. The riffs are killer. The vocals were, fantastic. But they're one of those we're back bands. They come back and I think Heavier Than Thou. I'll show them a little bit more. This came out in 86, so this would have been a perfect end to their career as a band. They would have gone a good 6 for 6 perfection. Speaking of which, I do need to pick up those other 2 records. When they came back in 2011 with The Vengeance and it was just extremely fucking tiring. Like, you could tell they were old, but they just sounded old. They sounded tired. They just kind of struck me as like a word board. But let's go do this. And it was this total like bar room, matching every cliche you could think of. It's one thing to sing about fucking when you're a young guy. Sing about sex, drugs, and rock and roll in the 80s. It's a totally different thing when you're in your 60s and doing it. I don't really know how to explain it. It kind of reminds me of like those weekend warriors that come out on their fucking Harleys. And they're just like we're back, baby. You know, just kind of, I don't know. Just like old and slow and tired, and I just want to take my Harley to the beach. That's the vibe it gives me. I don't know how to explain it any better than that, but it's just really bad. Just the most generic, like, butt rock you could think of. And then they did Hollywood, same exact thing, and then Brotherhood of Metal, which it's like, God, just please stop. But a band I will still always hold close to my heart based on the first six albums I did. So with that, you know, it doesn't really ruin their legacy for me. You know, it's not like they're selling out or anything. It's just they're kind of continuing, you know, something that was appropriate in their 20s and 30s.
Rock and roll.
Okay, this one's going to be pretty divided because there's going to be a lot of people that are going to be like, well, that band always sucked. I don't know. There's also going to be a lot of people that are going to be like, they never sucked. Well, that's definitely not true. Talking about Mon and Marth. So, first four albums. So, One Cent from the Golden Hall. 98. The Avenger. From, what was it, 2? I think it was 99, I believe. Yeah, it was 99. The Crusher. 2001. This one does crush. Love the drums on it. Listen to Annihilation of Hammer Fist. And then Versus the World. After that is my cutoff. So, Fate of Norns was terrible, to put it nicely. I don't know why I own this with Odin on our side. But it manages to be even worse. And Fate of Norn's issue is, they just sound like they got paid, right? You can tell they're just kind of, you know, honing it in, phoning it. Is that how you say it? Anyway, I'm tired. Might be a little buzzed on top of that. Pointing it in. But, to me, that album was the death of Amon Amarth. Like, Fate of Norns just sounded uninspired, super generic, like retreads of what they were already doing on Versus the World. But this was like, was so freaking clean and polished, and they relied solely on fucking melodic hooks, and has been the rest of their career. And a lot of people like it. I'm not saying it's objectively terrible. I mean, to me it is, but I'm not saying it's a fact. You know, everybody's got different opinions, which is cool. But Valhalla Awaits Me. Do do do. Does that sound like fucking barbaric Viking metal? No, it's fucking Swedish pop metal. I have a hard time even calling half of their stuff metal, you know? But anyway, back to the older shit. You could kind of tell in Versus the World, while I do enjoy this album, you could kind of see where they were going. Starting to rely more on the melodic hooks. Starting to carry melodies throughout the entire songs. But they were still really good. It wasn't cheesy to me. It was just kind of like a chill know, melodic death metal album. But the first three, let me get a fair view. This is melodic, but it's also raw and barbaric. Like, it's, if I had to throw recommendations, you know, from this band to anybody, it'd be for sure the first three. I would suggest giving Versus the World a shot, but I have a feeling most people wouldn't like that, at least the crowd that I talked to. But the first three is very respectable melodic death metal. It doesn't have that fucking, you know, polished cheese on it. It's very, like, what you would expect from, you know, Norseman playing metal. So, it's a shame, man. If they had cut it after those first three albums, or first four, but especially the first three, I mean, with that perfect discography. Okay. I forgot to pull it. I have it on CD, but I also have it on vinyl. Lair of the Minotaur. So that's the one I have on wax as well. War Metal Battlemaster from 2008. And this is, why am I forgetting the name? The Ultimate Destroyer. Carnage from 04. Ultimate Destroyer is from 06, by the way. This one's really heartbreaking because this is one of the first, like, extreme metal bands I ever got into. And just how insanely fucking heavy they were without being in a specific category. So, they weren't death metal, they weren't thrash, they weren't sludge, they weren't doom, they weren't hardcore, but they managed to throw all those styles together and make their own fucking, you know, their sound out of it. And these first three records are just so fucking brutal. I mean, it's like a face fucked with a sledgehammer. I mean, at least how I fucking perceive it. But if I were to throw a track at you to check out, go to the Carnage album and play the song Warlord. And if that riff doesn't make you want to just shadow box with dumbbells, I don't know what to tell you. Dinner. I don't want to do it too loud. Everybody's sleeping. Ultimate Destroyer, I would say overall is their heaviest album. Grizzly Hound of the Pit, Jesus Christ. And opening track for War Metal Battlemaster, which is Horde of Undead Vengeance. One of the best album openers of all time. Yeah, fantastic. So anyway, they decided to put out Evil Power in 2010. Gone is the violence. Gone is the fucking sheer horror. I no longer thought of... I mean, the cover was cool, but it no longer was a thick enough battle axe as, you know, cleaving off people's heads or anything like that. And that's what these first three albums remind me of, man. It's just extremely fucking barbaric. Like, bone-crunching heavy metal. And the last album, to me, just sounded like a fucking hardcore album without really being hardcore. It was not heavy. The lyrics were juvenile as fuck. And then they kind of disappeared, and then 8 years later put out an EP, which is like Dragon Slayer or something, which I actually thought was pretty decent, but it didn't match up to these three, so and I'm not sure we'll ever hear content from them again. It's really disappointing based on how amazing these three albums were. So yeah, Lair of the Minotaur, but yeah, definitely check those albums out. I can't think of any reason that people wouldn't like them if you're into extremely heavy music.
All right, I got three more. Oh, you pull out some more vinyl.
Okay, yep, I'm going to Morbid Angel. That was my chair. And maybe I'll flip that.
Once again, why not?
So yeah, Morbid Angel. Kind of obvious to a lot of people, at least in the circle I talk to, but there are people that will defend them to the death. Abominations, which I actually consider their debut. I know technically it's not, but to me it is. Now, where to put it? Now, how would this stack up against Altars of Madness? Because that's an age-old question. I don't know. Obviously, Altars, was the one I heard first, just because I'm in that age group. They're hard to tell, man. They're both extremely unique, but I will say I like Mike Browning's vocals more. I liked his drumming more. But this does have Visions from the Dark Side, so I don't know, that's a tough one. Get back to me in a few years. We have Covenant, which I think is a great record, in a way kind of underrated. I feel like people kind of skip over this one, or they'll be like, yeah, it was alright, it was just a little too weird. That's kind of what I like about it. It's sort of a weird, trippy album. It's very dark and desolate. Got these weird, like, windy riffs on it. And then, okay, so another album I brought up in 10 good overrated albums. My opinion on this one has changed. So it had been a while by the time I brought that album up, that I had listened to it. Why listen to it after making that video? I gotta say, I can't get through Covenant. I can't do it. Bores me to fucking tears. I still enjoy The Lion's Den based on that, like that last minute of it, that really cool riff and the drum fills. Yeah, you kind of tell they're too busy flaunting their rock star image to actually, you know, record quality death metal. That's why I hear from everybody who's their age is they were just the biggest fucking douche, but not all of them. But mainly Trey, and based on footage I've seen of him recently, telling people if you don't like my music, fuck you. Seems like he hasn't changed. Then they would recover, in my opinion, with Domination. Gets a lot of shit, but yeah, I've already said before, I dig this album. It kind of goes back to that Blessed Are the Sick territory. Formulas. This is another weird one. Kind of gets a little too disinteresting towards the end. At least for me. I'll be honest, among the ones that I like, it's probably the one I listen to the least. Yep, Gateways. So, Eric Rutan is back. And, I think this is kind of their scariest album. A lot of people would go with Altars. I think Gateways is just on another level of fucking evilness. But after that, Heretic. Not awful, but just bland. Never needed that one. Elude, we all know, is fucking bad. The Kingdom's Disdain is the one that I remember when it came out. Based on what I heard, I'm like, this album's gonna get fucking smoked by all the listeners. And to my surprise, it received a lot of praise from these Morbid Angel diehards. And I don't know if it was genuine or not, but to me, it just sounded like a band that was like, we just need to put a death metal album out again. That way people jump back on board. It doesn't matter if it's good or not. It just has to be death metal. That's the whole vibe I got from it. Like, let's just wash our hands of Elude. Pretend that never happened. But to me, a good death metal album it is not. So, another, and based on how things are looking, I hate to say it, I feel like this band is going to end tragically. I really hate to say that, but that's kind of how it's looking. Okay, now I have two more. I look right behind me and there's another one. Yep, Vital Remains. So, I forgot my, can't forget my compilation. Yeah. The Horrors of Hell comp, of course, has a has the Excruciating Pain demo, which is one of my favorite death metal demos ever. Reduced to Ashes is really good too, but I much prefer Excruciating Pain. Let Us Pray, fantastic debut. A little slow in some spots. Doesn't really hold my interest throughout the entire thing, but a very enjoyable album. Into Cold Darkness. Incredible. 95. Forever Underground. I've already addressed this album as being among my favorite 90s albums ever. 97. Such a unique fucking album. Dawn of the Apocalypse, which kind of has that Deicide sound to it. And then, of course, they would get Glenn Benton from Deicide. Put out Dechristianized, which I thought was a huge downgrade. And then Icons of Evil, which, dude, what the fuck are you doing? I just felt like on all the albums that I showed, they obviously had a lot of speed, but they would know when to change it up. They would have like the appropriate, you know, tempos kind of structuring around each other. I sometimes wish I was a professional music reviewer just so I could practice speaking fucking, you know, dictionary terms. But they had this formula that I felt like was absolutely perfect, especially on the Forever Underground album. A lot of speed, but there were also a lot of transitions in the pacing that, you know, you weren't getting on Dechristianized and Icons of Evil. It was basically just straight blast for 10 fucking minutes under, like, wafer thin, you know, guitar tone and production. Especially on Dechristianized was extremely thin. I mean, it was kind of had like that tinny sound, and I thought Glenn's vocals were way too high in the mix. It just, and his patterns, you know, I love, you know, I've said before, I love Deicide, of course, but Glenn just didn't sound good to me on those Vital Remains albums. I thought his patterns were terrible, to be honest. Not that I don't think it was his fault, because obviously he's not the brains behind the band. But was it Dave Suzuki? Hey, he's the main guy, right? But sorry, yeah, he just wasn't a good fit, and on paper. Especially because, like I said, Dawn of the Apocalypse, I was basically like, let's do a little homage to Deicide, because it kind of sounds like them. Now, had he been on that album, I feel like it would have been really good. But just with how they went, like, way too fucking hyper into the blasting and the noodly technical riffs, I thought kind of, because for me, Glenn's voice doesn't fit over noodly technical riffs, you know. His voice is more so for like abrasive, muscly riffs, and there definitely wasn't any muscle in Dechristianized or Icons of Evil, for that matter, in my opinion. I know a lot of people that love those two records over everything else. Alright, last one. This one I know is going to surprise some people. Make sure I grabbed them all. Okay. Running Wild, Gates of Purgatory. This is one of, if not my favorite, back when they were good old dirty speed metal. Kind of had their own sound. Branded and Exiled, the fantastic follow-up. Still dirty speed metal. And then after that, I think was Port Royal, which I don't own. I know it's a great record, I don't know why I don't own it. Under Jolly Roger. So, you know, by this time they've fully embraced the pirate theme, but still dirty fucking heavy metal that are very distinguishable between songs. And then this is where they start to lose me. So, Blazing Stone. This came out, I think this was 90 or 91. It was basically when Painkiller came out. But obviously, they got the name Running Wild from Judas Priest. To me, it just sounds like them trying to sound like Painkiller, or even Ram It Down with a pirate twist on it. And the cool thing with Priest is they can do those songs and you can tell every single one apart. Running Wild, my ears can't. You know, Blazing Stone, I think, is a decent record. But like I said, it's where they start to lose me. This is where the riffs become really happy and cheesy. And kind of, like I mentioned with Amon Amarth, that's kind of like, that's what it kind of reminds me of. That just that super polished, like, clean fucking, you know, twin leads harmonizing with each other and, you know, swirling their tongues around and shit. I don't like it. And this is officially where they just drop off. Pile of Skulls. Absolutely full-blown butt pirate at this point. Masquerade even worse. But they got the song Demonized. That one stands out because it sounds like a fucking, you know, pop punk song. So it doesn't stand out in a good way. I was kind of tricked into getting this one. This is a Blood on Blood from 2021. That's a song I wanted for the Iron Times. I heard that. It's a 10-minute long song. I was like, oh cool dude. They like did a really good catchy ballad. Maybe the rest of the album is catchy. Nope. But, you know, side one, of course. And, fuck, they're still doing it. 30 years later. Yeah, I've noticed over the period of these albums, the worse they got, the longer they got. So, their early albums, everything was like 30 minutes, 35 minutes. Fuck, dude. Once they start in the mid-90s, hour and 10 minutes, it's like, fucking Iron Maiden now. So, yep, that's my list of peachy bands that went all poo-poo and never recovered. So let me know your thoughts. Chances are you're going to disagree with a bunch of them. And that's why I intended. So take care, guys.